And so for the record, council members who are present are Aaron Dorkin, musician and music educator from Ann Arbor, Michigan, Paul Hodes, attorney, musician, former member of Congress from Concord, New Hampshire, Deepa Gupta, philanthropic professional from Chicago, Illinois, Joan Israelite, arts consultant from Kansas City, Missouri, Maria Rosario Jackson, urban planning and community policy specialist from Los Angeles, California, Emil Kong, music professor and arts administrator from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, Mas Masamoto, author and organic farmer from Delray, California, Barbara Ernst Prey, visual artist from Oyster Bay, New York, Ronnie Ramaswamy, dancer, choreographer and teacher from Minneapolis, Minnesota, Olga Viso, museum director also from Minneapolis, and we have on the phone Bruce Carter, music educator and researcher from Miami Beach, Florida. We regret that council members Rick Lowe, Lee Greenwood, Maria Lopez de Leon, Irvin Mayfield, and Charlotte Kessler are unable to join us this morning. Also want to introduce our new senior deputy chair, Laura Callanan. We're so glad you're here, Laura. And because Emil, there's Emil, we will just wait a moment so he can join us at the table so we can start. Welcome, Emil. This is a wonderful welcome for, no problem. Okay, now let's get back down to business. May I have a motion to approve the minutes from our October council meeting?
Watching on. Carol Walton, our senior advisor for programs and partnerships, and also Jillian Miller, director of guidelines and panel operations, to take us through the section of the meeting.
Thank you, Jane. Good morning, council members. We will proceed now with the application review and guidelines review sections of the agenda. The tally of the votes will be announced at the end of today's session. The council will be voting by ballot today on award recommendations totaling more than $77 million in three funding areas: artworks, state and regional partnerships, and leadership initiatives. These funding recommendations are found in the corresponding sections of the council book. Council Member Carter, joining by teleconference, has been instructed to email votes to Kim Jefferson in these three funding categories immediately at the conclusion of this part of the meeting. In order for your vote to be tallied, you must be present at the time of the motion, discussion, and vote. Council members' affiliations have been recorded in the council book and will be attached to your ballots, and each member has been provided an opportunity to update this information prior to the meeting. Before voting, council members should review the list of recommendations and rejections and add to the list provided in your folders any affiliations that may be missing. Council members are recorded as not voting on applications with which they are affiliated. This list becomes part of the agency's official record. After brief summaries of the three funding areas, council members will have an opportunity to ask questions and/or discuss the recommendations before voting by ballot. May I have a motion to consider the recommended grants and rejections under artworks, partnerships, and leadership in the council book?
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Now I will summarize the three funding areas on which you will be voting and then pause for any comments or questions from council members. First, the artworks category is the agency's primary category of funding for the arts disciplines and encourages and supports the following four outcomes: creation, the creation of art that meets the highest standards of excellence; engagement, public engagement with diverse and excellent art; learning, lifelong learning in the arts; and livability, the strengthening of communities through the arts. Projects recommended today are the second group of artworks applications brought to the council this fiscal year. The first half was considered at the October 2014 meeting. In July 2014, the agency received 1,661 eligible applications requesting more than $84.4 million in 2015 support. Recommended for the council's approval are 942 projects, totaling up to $25,319,000. Grants are recommended to 57% of all applicants, with amounts ranging from $10,000 to $100,000, and an average grant amount of $26,878. Recommended projects span 13 disciplines and fields. Direct grants are recommended to 45 states, the District of Columbia, and Puerto Rico. Are there any comments or questions from the council? If not, please mark your ballots. State and regional partnership agreements assist the nation's state arts agencies and regional arts organizations in their support of the arts. By law, 40% of arts endowment appropriated program funds are awarded in this way. State arts agencies will utilize NEA support in combination with state appropriated funding to support arts organizations, schools, and artists in producing arts projects in communities across the country. This year, a total of $39.9 million is being recommended for the states and $7.9 million for the regions. Are there any comments or questions? If not, you may please mark your ballots. Leadership initiatives support a wide variety of projects of national and field-wide significance. At this meeting, the council is requested to approve funding for 9 initiatives totaling $3,926,000. Support is requested for the Arts Education Partnership, a consortium of more than 130 national organizations representing the arts and education fields, as well as the government and the private sector. The Arts Education Partnership promotes the essential role of the arts in enabling every student to succeed in school and reach high levels of achievement and competence in the arts. Next, U.S. Artists International, a program that showcases the excellence, diversity, and vitality of U.S. artists and arts organizations at international arts markets around the world and supports the participation of U.S. artists at other significant cultural events abroad. Performing Arts Discovery, a pilot program to help U.S. regional arts organizations showcase American performing arts groups in their respective regions to international arts programmers. The NEA National Heritage Fellowships and Awards Ceremony. The Big Read, an initiative to enhance literature's role in American culture. Poetry Out Loud, which encourages the nation's youth to learn about great poetry through memorization, recitation, and performance, and helps students master public speaking skills and learn about their literary heritage. Shakespeare in American Communities, a program that brings professional theater performances and educational activities to students in schools across America. The NEA Jazz Masters Awards Ceremony, and 19 projects in research artworks, which will build evidence about the value and impact of the arts and encourage strong partnerships and exchanges of information among researchers. Are there any questions about the leadership initiatives? If not, you may please mark your ballots. Council members joining by teleconference, you may now email your votes to Kim Jefferson on those 3 categories. Finally, there are several items under the awards update section of the council book. These grants have been awarded under the chairman's delegated authority and are brought to the council's attention at this meeting, but no vote is necessary. Included are 162 Challenge America grants in 45 states, 8 20% amendments, and 3 interagency agreements. Thank you. We will move to the guidelines review portion of the agenda. At this meeting, the council is asked to consider 3 sets of guidelines for fiscal year 2016, partnership agreements, our town, and the NEA National Heritage Fellowships. I now turn to Jillian Miller, Director of the Office of Guidelines and Panel Operations, to summarize the guidelines up for a vote at this meeting.
Thank you, Carol. Good morning. At this meeting, you're reviewing 3 sets of guidelines, and they're all updates to existing categories. Your first set of guidelines is for partnership agreements. These guidelines define the agency's funding to its state and regional partners, and there are a couple of changes to highlight for you. The review criteria have been refocused for greater clarity and alignment with the application requirements. Also, the review criteria have been expanded for projects that strengthen the folk and traditional arts. Your second set of guidelines is for our town. These guidelines are for creative placemaking projects that contribute to the livability of communities and place the arts at their core. And there are a couple of changes here as well. We've added language to incorporate opportunities for artists to participate in community processes and to tie projects to community priorities. Also, we've relaxed some of the restrictions on the numbers of applications that can be submitted. In cases where there are multiple applications, we'll consider the capacity of the applicant to carry out and sustain two Our Town projects. And finally, your last set of guidelines is for one of the agency's honorific fellowship categories. The NEA National Heritage Fellowships honor master folk and traditional artists. And the only change here is that nominations will remain active for 2 years instead of four.
Are there any comments or questions from the council for Jillian? If not, may I have a motion to approve the guidelines? Thank you. Is there a second? All in favor, please say aye. Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you, Carol and Jillian. All right, since our last council meeting, in October, I've had a lot of time to spend on the road, and I've been to Indiana, Southern California, Northern California, New York, Connecticut, Michigan. I've been to Florida twice, Louisiana, and Wisconsin. And we won't go through every site visit, but I do want to give you a few highlights, and you can turn your attention to the screen for some images. I went to Minneapolis, and I met with National Council member Rani Ramaswamy, toured her dance studio, Ragamala Dance, and for three decades, Rani has worked to embed the classical Indian dance form called Bharatanatyam into America's artistic landscape, and we're so indebted to you, Rani, for enriching our national culture. Thank you. I also toured the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis with director and council member Olga Viso. The Walker is one of the nation's visionary museums, and it was so wonderful to see it from its director's perspective. And in New Orleans, I spoke at NASA, the National Assembly of State Arts Agencies Conference, and I had an opportunity to visit with council member Irvin Mayfield in his hometown. And I also explored some of the many ways the arts enrich the New Orleans culture. I took a hard hat tour of the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Foundation, which manages Jazz Fest, and saw how the next generation is growing up with the same arts-rich background that Irvin enjoyed at the Lusher Charter School, which has become one of the city's highest performing schools thanks to the innovative arts-integrated curriculum. In Miami, Florida, council member Bruce Carter was a wonderful guide as we toured the Young Arts Foundation, the New World Symphony, and the Perez Art Museum of Miami, which was founded by former council member Jorge Perez. And I also visited the community of Opa-locka, which is reimagining a lot of its previous barriers into public spaces and affordable housing with public art installations. In Detroit, I attended the SphinxCon National Conference to Address Diversity in the Arts, founded by our national council member, Aaron Dworkin. And I also saw the development of Detroit's cultural scene and visited the Sugar Hill Arts District and the Woodward Garden Block. And the city is on the move. It's very exciting to experience the renewed commitment and energy. In Los Angeles, I toured the Little Tokyo Cultural Eco District with council member Maria Rosario Jackson. This initiative is designed to preserve the cultural heritage of the area's Japanese American community. And our Director of Arts Education, Ayanna Hudson, and I also visited several arts education programs. And our visit to the Turnaround School in Compton, California was memorable. So here is an elementary school with students from very low-income households located in an area where there are very few opportunities. And as a result of their arts program, which is funded by the National Endowment for the Arts, teachers, the principal, school board members, and parents all noted that students are doing better on their standardized tests. They're retaining an understanding of the school subjects better than ever before, and even in the non-arts areas, such as science and math, they don't skip classes, and they've seen significant changes in their kids for the better. That is the power of the arts. Now I want to tell you about some upcoming events. On April 20th, next month, we will present the 2015 NEA Jazz Masters Awards Ceremony and Concert in New York City. This award is the nation's highest honor in jazz, and this year's recipients are so deserving. Our 2015 class of jazz masters include keyboardist, composer, arranger, and band leader Carla Bly, saxophonist, composer, and educator George Coleman, saxophonist, flutist, and composer Charles Lloyd, and jazz presenter and club owner Joe Siegel, who will receive the A.B. Spellman NEA Jazz Master's Award for Jazz Advocacy. This is going to be a great event with performances by past jazz masters and young musicians because we want to show the continuing circle of one of America's most innovative art forms. We'll stream the concert on our website at arts.gov, and we'll also live tweet events under the hashtag NEAJazz15. And the following week, April 28th and 29th, we'll celebrate the 10th anniversary of Poetry Out Loud. And since it began, Poetry Out Loud has helped nearly 3 million students gain confidence, polish their public speaking skills as they learn about and internalize our shared literary heritage. It has been so fun to follow the state competitions on social media, and we know that a lot of the students, the schools, and the teachers from around the country have their eyes set on the national finals here in Washington, D.C. So if you cannot attend the finals in person, I hope you'll tune into our live webcast at arts.gov. Follow along on Twitter using the hashtag POL15. On April 28th, we will hold our National Service Organizations meeting. Our service organizations provide support networks for the artistic disciplines because every field has specific needs that are related to its artistry and its operations. And these meetings allow us the opportunity to stay connected face-to-face with those who are in the field, working to strengthen and expand the country's cultural ecosystem. And at the end of May, we are going to launch our sixth summer of Blue Star Museums. And this is held from Memorial Day through Labor Day. Blue Star Museums offer free admission to service members and their families at more than 2,200 museums across the country. This program engages our service members in the arts in a way that lets them know how much we appreciate what they do on our behalf, and it allows the families to spend time with one another without having to worry about financial stress. This is educational, and it connects people to great collections, programs, and activities that the museums have to offer. And so here's one quote from a military spouse. "My family found a way to spend time together, have an educational summer, and spend little to no money doing it. My family could not afford a beach vacation in a big fancy hotel, but we could afford day trips to Blue Star Museums, and we never even had to leave our home state." So we'll announce more specific details about the next Blue Star Museums launch for this summer very soon. So this concludes my agency updates. Are there any questions from the council? Well, now I'd like to invite our Director of Public Affairs, Jessamyn Sarmiento, to give you updates on our upcoming 50th anniversary celebration.
Hello, thank you. So we've been planning activities for the 50th anniversary now for months, and we have a great outline to share with you today on where we are and what's coming up in September of this year as we launch the anniversary. To mark the anniversary year, we wanted to update our logo to reflect our 50 years. Because our logo is quite complicated, there was not much we could do that was dramatic, although we definitely looked at those options. To be straightforward and to the point, and without changing our brand too much, we simply removed the artwork's slogan, and replaced it with celebrating 50 years. In some cases, we'll use the Arts for All of Us logo tagline down at the bottom that you see right there. The year of celebration will launch on the 29th of September, the date President Johnson signed the National Foundation on the Arts and Humanities Act of 1965, which created the National Endowment for the Arts and the National Endowment for the Humanities. And this is when we'll begin using the logo on our NEA branded materials and platforms for the anniversary year. We'll share it with our partners as well, so if and when it makes sense, they can incorporate it into their marketing materials. The overarching goal of 50th anniversary activities is to provide a variety of entry points for people, everyone from our key constituents to the general public, to engage with us across the year. We will do this in a number of ways, but the important driver will be ensuring we present a clear and convincing story of our impact on the rich and diverse arts opportunities in communities across the nation. From broadening the public's understanding of why what the NEA does matters, to expanding and diversifying their understanding of where and how the arts impact communities and individuals, we will also aim our activities so that they help to expand the number of people who consider themselves participants in the arts. through materials, products, and a better and more coordinated message carried out by our staff and among our partners and grantees, we will aim to do this. Here we go. We have some tactical outcomes as well, which will include developing a microsite for the 50th anniversary that will house 50 years of multimedia storytelling on the impact of the NEA and the arts in America. Leadership initiatives will give the public and partners a new and exciting way to interact with the NEA. And we're creating an infographic suite of tools from video and other interactive elements that will help the NEA tell the NEA story in a fun and engaging way. And we're creating, for the first time, a hard copy Leave Behind brochure overview of the NEA that will be available on our website and also through our partners and grantees. So how do we get to these outcomes? Our strategy is to use digital to broadly engage with audiences across our NEA platforms, new platforms that we'll launch, and those of other third parties. The campaign will be driven and supported by a digital hub on arts.gov. Along with these digital strategies and elements to attract online and offline attention, will all be combined with in-person events, chairman travel, and convenings. The principal element that will connect all of our activities is storytelling. Our storytelling will better connect with audiences by making the stories personal and relevant, hearing from those who have been impacted by what we do and who we support. During our 50th anniversary year, Americans will have the opportunity to share what art means to them and why it is an important and essential part of their lives. The NEA will take these stories and present them in a way that supports and validates our agency and the meaningful work we do. I'll talk a little bit more about this initiative of story collection in a few minutes. As much as we can, we'll also go local to ensure our partners and grantees are featured prominently in the story that we tell together. There are many ways that this will play out over the year. The year of celebration will comprise a number of public-facing initiatives. As you can see, it will include leadership initiatives, which we'll announce the details of at a National Press Club media event on the day of the launch, September 29th. A media showcase, which I'll talk about further in a minute, a number of convenings and other events throughout the year, including a big one on the future of the arts that will take place in 2016. There will be a few celebratory events, some here in DC, others that will take place in local communities across the nation as our chairman travels. And finally, we'll connect with broad and diverse audiences through a number of fun and engaging crowdsourcing activities. So stay tuned for information on those. So now we get to the fun part, telling our collective story. The media showcase will consist of a stories campaign. The NEA, partners, and others will use storytelling to demonstrate how our investments have sparked some of the most impactful artistry in our history, as well as stories on our continued investments in developing arts in rich communities and experiences for individuals. Here are a few of the programs within the story campaign. 50 States, 50 Stories is a place where the public, as well as state and local arts agencies and regional arts organizations, can tell their own stories and encourage stories from grantees. Even though it's called 50 States, 50 Stories, there will be more than 50 stories. And of course, we fund more than 50 states. There's 55 states and territories. So the stories will, we hope, fill and represent a broad collection of stories from the field. NEA Sparks the Arts will feature NEA multimedia presentations highlighting some of the great work we've invested in over the past 50 years. And finally, we'll release a 3-minute sizzle reel that will be a cool, attention-getting video on our 50-year history to give people a quick overview of our role, impact on the arts and culture and creative activities in America. Storytelling has always been a key strategy that many look to help tell their story. The arts have been missing in that story, and we are going to put that on the map. So these great stories that will make up the 50 States, 50 Stories campaign, how do we get them? In February, we soft launched this webpage as part of arts.gov to collect these stories from the public, as well as our partners and others. It's at arts.gov/tell-us-your-story. Or you can go to it through that button on the top that says help us celebrate our 50th anniversary. Click on it and it will take you to this page. We encourage people to visit the page, share it with your friends and colleagues, and ultimately submit a video, audio, written or still photograph about why the arts matter to you. We've shared this information with all of our state arts agencies, local arts agencies, and regionals, and here's an example of how they are helping us promote the story collection. I believe this is Arizona's website. So the next two slides are going to show you some examples of stories that we've already been receiving, and we'll give you kind of a highlight of the plethora of stories that we're going to be promoting and demonstrating on our website during the 50th anniversary. This first one is from Jansen McGuire, who writes that his summer spent volunteering as an artworks apprentice was his best ever. He says he feels so honored to have been with this group of people working toward a common goal of creating a beautiful work of art. The second example is from Jeffrey Levitt, who writes that doing art is a way for him to express his inner creativity. He shared a few examples of his artwork with us. So these and more stories will make up the mosaic of arts reflections that will help us tell a more impactful and relevant story of arts across the nation and how it impacts people's lives. Thank you very much. Any questions?
All right, well, thank you so much, Jess. Our next presentation will focus on new research findings from our Office of Research and Analysis, and these three reports were released in January, and they illuminate arts participation and production, from the economic impact of the arts to how people engage with the arts and to reasons why people might not participate in the arts. And so here to tell you more about these studies is our Director of Research and Analysis, Sunil Iyengar. Sunil? Sunil's going to also be joined by Arni Fishbaugh from the Montana Arts Council, Ned Canty from Opera Memphis, and Ellin O'Leary and Storm White from Youth Radio in Oakland, California. And so each person will discuss the impact of these studies on their own work. But I'll turn it over to Sunil right now.
Thank you, Jane. And good morning, council members, NEA staff, special guests, and members of the public. I'm going to be sharing with you selected findings from three research products out of the NEA's Office of Research and Analysis. My hope is that together they'll provide a clearer understanding of how arts participation or cultural engagement occurs in this country, and what's the value of the production that drives that engagement. I'll then turn it over to three panelists I'm grateful to have with me this morning. Grateful because research too often exists in an isolated, abstract realm. And here instead, we have three speakers who will touch on key aspects of the NEA studies as they affect their own fields of practice. This will lend color to the findings, or what Shakespeare calls local habitation and a name. Each set of findings I'll discuss draws from a different data set, but they have at least three things in common. They are each nationally representative, they are federally supported, and each data set covers the period ending in 2012. Let's start with the production piece first. Last year, we joined forces with the Bureau of Economic Analysis at the Department of Commerce, the same folks who bring you the nation's GDP numbers every quarter, so we could get a finer read on the total economic contributions of the arts. Working with them, we established what's called a satellite account on arts and cultural production. And also some of the findings for this section that I'll be showing to you today are also published in the influential newsletter that the BA puts out called the Survey of Current Business, was published in January. Arts and cultural industries in this country make up $698 billion in gross domestic product, which is, of course, the final economic value of all goods and services in this country. That's a very respectable 4.32% of the US GDP. Someone this morning was pointing out another way of phrasing it is it's $1 in every $25 of the GDP. So that's important to keep in mind. Key drivers of this growth are broadcasting, movies and videos, publishing, arts and cultural retail, trade, the creative component of advertising, but also performing arts and independent artists, which themselves contribute about $35 billion to our GDP. Now together, these are nearly all service industries, which underscores the notion that the arts are embedded in what we call the ideas or innovation-based economy. Further, it so happens that half of that economic value generated by the nation's copyright intent is, sorry, half the economic value generated by the nation's copyright intensive industries, that's a term used by the US Patents and Trademark Office, half of that economic value, or $433 billion, comes from the production of arts and cultural commodities alone. Another point I want to make here is that from this satellite account, we also know that arts and cultural industries employ 4.7 million workers. Indeed, we're in the process of working with the BEA on trying to get this information down to the state level, indeed all this GDP information down to the state level. One goal is to help better envision how artists and arts workers contribute measurably as entrepreneurs in their regions. Fittingly, in a moment, you'll hear from Arni Fishbaugh, Executive Director of Montana Arts Council, who addressed this topic in her presentation about the Montana Entrepreneur Program. I know some of you in the back won't be able to see all of this, but here's the relative ranking of the arts value added to GDP compared with other sectors. You can see that it's actually higher than the value contributed by construction, by transportation, by agriculture, even travel and tourism. Another key finding is that unlike many other sectors, and in fact the U.S. economy at large, arts and cultural industries are in aggregate running a trade surplus. That is, we're exporting about $25 billion more than we're currently importing. Trade surpluses are linked to job growth and economic growth generally. Viewed from another angle, they suggest a high degree of appreciation for American or homegrown arts beyond our shores. Note that more issue briefs about the satellite account and its implications are posted to the arts.gov website. Now I'm going to shift gears and talk about a second report we issued in January, When Going Gets Tough, Barriers and Motivations Affecting Arts Attendance. As you'll see in a moment, our research has shown that attending museums, galleries, art exhibits, and live music, dance, or theater performances are merely some of the varied ways that Americans get their art. But as a national funder of some of the leading providers of art exhibits and events, we naturally wanted to know about why people choose to go to certain arts events, what motivates them, and importantly, what holds them back. It turns out that the topmost motivations cited by people who attended a visual or performing arts event in the last year is socializing with family and friends, with 3 out of 4 people who attended the arts naming this as their reason for going. When you think about the arts, it shouldn't be a surprise, but it's impressive to see the number. We do know through some of our own research and studies from the behavioral and social sciences that arts participation is closely linked with social and civic engagement, and that some arts venues, for example, fairs and festivals, are particularly conducive to this outcome. But we also see that the place where the art is exhibited or performed makes a huge difference, that the physical characteristics of the arts venue clearly reflect decisions about whether or not to attend. A finding that's interesting, especially in light of some of our work related to creative placemaking. And third, vying with high quality art as a motivating factor, we see that gaining knowledge or learning something new is an important value for those who attend arts events. Let's look at this broken down by type of arts event. The point of this is to show you get different answers when you ask museum visitors versus performance goers about what motivates them. For people who saw an exhibit, learning new things and experiencing high quality art and the location itself played a bigger role than they did for performance goers. Socializing and enjoying the work of a specific artist were the big draws for people who went to see performances. Why does any of this matter unless you're a sociologist? Well, we've seen throughout the last several decades of our arts participation survey that adults are attending certain kinds of arts events, classical music, jazz, opera, ballet, theater, and visiting art museums at far lower rates than they used to. So we can provide a service to the nation's cultural providers, it's our hope anyway, by showing them what drives people to attend or not to attend. And here's one thing we learned. 13% of all adults, that's 31 million Americans, expressed an interest in attending some specific arts event in the past year, but they made the ultimate decision not to. Understanding those folks is key to expanding cultural engagement nationwide. So what are the barriers? The top three are lack of time, often because of work, the price of admission, and difficulty accessing the site of the exhibit or performance, in some cases because of a disability or illness. We know that many arts organizations and funders are doing what they can to hold down costs of the ticket and that free or subsidized programs are often part of the equation. Note that the cost issue here is reported as more of a concern for performance goers than for exhibit viewers, probably because many museums offer discounted or free admission. Also, it's significant that lack of time is more of a factor for not attending exhibits than it is for not attending performances. Interestingly, a large share of young parents or people with very young children fall into this category. which explains the need perhaps for more family-friendly arts programming. But I'd like also to amplify two other points. We've just learned through asking about reasons people give for arts attendance that the location of the event and the people they go with are especially important to them. Well, then it's also true that these very qualities deemed essential to the arts experience are deficient in cases where people choose not to attend. That is, either they couldn't find someone to go with, or they found the location too difficult to get to, in some cases because of a disability. Again, it's easy to view these as some of these as opportunities for cultural providers to restructure some of the formats and styles of arts presentation. In fact, Opera Memphis has been doing some fascinating work in this area, and you'll be hearing shortly from their general director, Ned Canty. So the third and last series of findings comes from the Survey of Public Participation in the Arts, which is, in a sense, the NEA's flagship research instrument. We've been conducting this survey periodically as in partnership with the U.S. Census Bureau, actually since 1982. And in the survey, we ask Americans about the types of events and activities they engaged with in the last year prior to the survey. In the run-up to the 2012 SPPA, as it's called, we did an overhaul of many sections of the survey to make it more relevant to changing demographics, technologies, and art forms and genres. First, one thing you start to realize looking at the survey results is that the number of people who take part in arts and cultural activities is actually quite large. In 2012, about 71% of the U.S. adult population, that's 167 million Americans, did some kind of arts activity through electronic media. Well over half read books or literature, that is, novel, short story, poem, or play, even though the numbers for reading in these individual categories have either held steady or waned over the last 10 years. And just over half attended some kind of visual exhibit or performing arts event. Now, I've just said this is a periodic survey and that we have trend data going back to 1982, but consider, back in the good old 80s or even the 90s, could we have imagined the proliferation of some of the media and technologies through which people are now enjoying and experiencing art of all kinds? For example, 44%, 103 million adults emailed, posted, or otherwise shared art using technology, and another 43% created, performed, or edited, or remixed art. And one of the things we're finding is when we review the past decade is that technology is a great enabler of arts creation. Demographic subgroups that previously have shown relatively low rates of participation, as measured by arts attendance, for example, are lighting up when it comes to the use of electronic media to create or perform art of their own. We could look at this by age, race, or socioeconomic status. Let's look at race, for example, and ethnicity. Among all American adults who created works of visual art in 2012, nearly two-thirds of African Americans used electronic media to do so. That compares with half of white Americans. At the same time, Asian Americans and other non-Hispanic groups were also relatively likely to use electronic media to create visual art. When it comes to music making through creation or performance, again, African Americans who did so were the most likely of all groups to have used electronic media for this purpose. But a close second is Hispanic Americans. In a moment, you'll be hearing from Ellin O'Leary of Youth Radio in Oakland, California, and one of her former students, Storm White. They'll talk more about how they are leveraging this interest to engage students in creating artwork and a new artistic storytelling model about their communities. Now, I could have showed you any number of slides about the SPPA data, and if you don't believe me, there are a whole bunch of reports out front for you to take, thick reports. But I wanted to land on this observation. We do have some state and regional data. Even as detailed as the census data are, we cannot cover every single state in detail, but we do provide some great regional and some state analysis. And this shows you some diversity of participation that we may not realize or we may take for granted when we see kind of the national picture of how, particularly around attendance or creating certain kinds of art. The other kinds of art that occurs, and it includes diverse traditions of art making in multiple art forms in different communities and regions all across the country. I want to remind you that this creativity connects back to the latent economic value I showed you at the start of this presentation, in a word, entrepreneurship. And this too is a form of participation, participation in our creative economy as a nation. Finally, as a service to the public, we, notably scholars, policymakers, and cultural providers, we've created a national archive of data that can be mined to examine further the value of arts and culture in American life. It's the National Archive of Data on Arts and Culture. You can Google it or just go to the NEA website. to explore. Thanks a lot. Are there any questions? Don't be shy, Moss.
I have a question. How much can you drill down on regional levels when you look at some of this data?
Well, it depends by the data set that I was talking about, but the economic piece, we are now in discussions, actually working very actively with the Bureau of Economic Analysis to get regional and state breakdown. So we could essentially, in an ideal world, and I think we're actually not so far from that, being able to understand what the arts and culture contributes to what's called the gross state product, rather than the gross domestic product. So to provide that equivalent, essentially, by the state, to the extent we can. We're still going through the data. And we may, in fact, have an opportunity to collect more input from others outside the NEA as part of that process. The other piece, the piece about attendance and barriers to attending or motivations, that unfortunately is only at the national level. The third piece on arts participation, we cover about 33 states that we feel good, solid, reliable data with currently with the NEA's relationship with the Census Bureau. We're now looking at getting even more states into the mix. We're actually in discussions again with them right now about broadening that. But we still have very good, obviously, national and regional representation.
Is that because certain states you have richer data to draw from, the 33 as opposed to all 50?
It has something to do with the state's composition and the diversity of people in the state. So the question, the census, I mean, do the census data accurately reflect the population diversity in each state? And so some states, we were not confident that we're getting every kind of sub-demographic group in that state fully represented. And for those 33 or so states, might be 32, we actually have, we feel very confident about that with the Census Bureau. So we've gone ahead and reported. That doesn't stop us from telling you out of the 33 or so, where do we see some interest and what's going on so far here. And that seems in line with what we're seeing on the regional level too. Any other questions? Okay, now I'd like to welcome up in a moment Arni Fishbaugh, Executive Director of the Montana Arts Council. A native Montanan who grew up on a wheat farm, Arni worked for many years in arts marketing and held positions with the Guthrie Theater in Minneapolis, the Houston Grand Opera, New York's Metropolitan Opera, and the National Video Corporation. Since Arni joined the Montana Arts Council in 1992, the agency has developed a number of initiatives that have become models for state arts agencies around the country. Among them are the Public Value Partnership, which provides grants that support operating expenses for nonprofit arts organizations, the Montana Entrepreneur Program, which helps rural and tribal artists become market ready, and you'll hear her talk about that today, and Montana's Circle of American Masters, which honors the state's visual folk artists. Arni?
Good morning. It's such a privilege to be here with you today. I want to start out by telling you how much the state arts councils across the nation value the National Endowment for the Arts and the National Council and all of the NEA staff. The state arts agencies are the strongest partners of the National Endowment for the Arts, and we just appreciate so much what you do, and I want to say we also love working with Laura Scanlon and Andy Mathis. We also so much appreciate Sunil and his staff and the great research work that they do, because the states take a lot of that data and turn it into our own advantage, and you'll hear a little bit about something that we did with our program. Anyway, kudos, and we just really appreciate everything that you do. Let me start by introducing you to the Montana Arts Council. Our brand, our promise, is to strengthen the creative economy of Montana. We'd like to paint a picture of Montana for you this morning, big sky country, so you know what our world looks like. First, it's very big. Over 700 miles wide and nearly 400 miles from north to south, we just passed, regrettably, 1 million people in population. Many of us are bummed by that. In fact, there are 2.5 times as many cows as people that live in our state. If our eastern border was in Washington, D.C., our western border would be in Chicago. 46 of Montana's 56 counties are designated as frontier, even more rural than rural, with less than 6 people per square mile. You know, when I grew up, in my little town, we had a 2-room schoolhouse in 8 grades with 2 teachers. There were 6 of us in the first grade, and by the time we got to the 6th grade, there were only 2 of us left. So that's the kind of smallness that we're talking about. Over 40% of all Montanans in the workforce hold more than 1 job. That's really an amazing fact. Over 40%, close to half. More than 85% of the incorporated businesses have fewer than 4 employees. So, you know, we're not a state that has a bunch of giant corporations, you know, running our industries. Here, and got so busy talking, I forgot to advance my slides. Okay, so that's over 40% of Montanans hold more than 1 job. So now, here, and no doubt most other places around the world, people are always asking artists, and I know all the artists in this room have been asked this, when are you going to get a real job? To that end, we respond, the arts are real jobs, and you'll find them in Montana. According to the Montana Department of Labor's 2012 study about artist employment, 1 out of every 60 people in Montana's labor market is a working artist. Now, just think about that. In this town of, or this state of less than 1 million people, or about 1 million people, 1 out of every 60 people is a working artist. 1 out of every 60 people in the labor market. Now, I want to talk a little bit about this because Sunil is directly responsible for our Montana Department of Labor study. In 2010, or whenever it was, that was the last time you did the study on artist employment, we got that research, we delved into it. It looks so interesting to us as Montanans and our people that I sent it over to the Department of Labor and I said, could you look at this from your Department of Labor viewpoint and see what you think? Well, they were just so impressed. And so the guy said, the staffer said, well, we think this is so impressive that we want to do our own report on this. So all of a sudden I had a Montana Department of Labor report, which in the eyes of my Montana legislators, you know, that has validity because it's produced by our own state. So that was really great. So back to the fact that 1 out of every 60 artists is in the labor market, or 1 out of every 60 people is in the labor market and an artist. The other interesting fact is that consistently for the last 4 decades, the growth in the percentage of artists as a part of the labor force has been 3 times the growth of the rest of the people in the labor force in Montana. And I think that's because Montana is a beautiful place to live. You get artists living there, they attract more artists. So it continues to expand and expand. Montana is a land of creativity. Who knew you could make wheat straw do this? The U.S. Chamber of Commerce ranks Montana first in the nation in entrepreneurship and innovation. They say, Montana's greatest source of national dominance came from the collection of arts, entertainment, recreation, and visitor industries. We really liked that they said arts before tourism. That was great. The Arts Council focuses our work on 3 outcomes: economic vitality, arts education, and producing public value for the arts. In economic vitality, we are practical. We support these concepts: careers, connections, and market expansion. We know that the number one need voiced by artists in our state and nationally, as a rule, is to get help with market expansion and markets. Now think about this. Think about the marketing challenge for artists who live in a place that many would call a frontier. You know, can you even see a neighbor? There. Our gold star model for market expansion is the Montana Artpreneur Program. We call it MAP. It is flexible, accessible, and affordable. It's geared to helping visual artists create a sustainable future in the business of art. It was started in 2009. It's now in its sixth year, and it's been an economic development training center for hundreds of artists throughout the state. We have a team of coaches in addition to our program director. These coaches have created learning cohorts of artists in rural communities, and each cohort consists of 6 to 12 artists. 350 artists have been participating, and these are primarily in rural communities throughout the state. This work has been funded through a collaboration of supporters, including the National Endowment for the Arts. Also partnered with LINC, which is Leveraging Investments in Creativity, the Emily Hall Tremaine Foundation, and the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Rural Communities Development Initiative. This support has given us the opportunity to move this program deep into our rural populations, on and off the reservations. One of the most important benefits of a MAP program cohort is the development of networks of artists who live close enough to each other to establish professional and long-lasting relationships. You know, artists work in isolation everywhere, and imagine, you know, when you're in a place like Montana. So this networking and connecting is one of the top benefits that artists tell us about. They spend 10 months together, meeting monthly, sometimes more often, developing their marketing and business skills, resulting in the creation of an entrepreneur's toolbox of 35 elements. They continue on by staying in touch after the course is over. They collaborate on exhibitions and marketing. They might develop co-ops, and they find lots of ways to share ideas and resources. We have hot off the press, the results from our first in-depth evaluation of the MAP program steered by a well-established researcher, Sorrell Phillips. We asked her to go deep and research MAP artist sales and the economic impact on their households from 2009 to 2013. 80 of the 250 artists that were contacted responded to the survey, and we were very pleased with the results. Artists responding generated a 275% increase in net art sales on average, some as high as $18,000. Now, for everybody that lives in a big city, you may think $18,000, well, heck, that's not very much money. But in Montana, that's one-third of the average per capita income. And it sends a lot of kids to college. They increase sales outside the state by close to one-third, and 21% of their gross personal income was derived from their art sales. They generated economic activity in the following areas: increased inventory, customer base, investment in art business, sales locations, and one of the things that's the most important is it really has helped them establish and increase pricing for and price points for in both retail and wholesale. Of the 80 artists responding to the survey, 22 received MAP certification. To become certified, artists must produce the complete toolbox of 35 professional business elements I mentioned earlier in order to be deemed market ready. The results from the MAP certified artists are higher in most cases than all program respondents responding to the survey. They generated a 391% increase in net art sales, an increase of out-of-state sales by 53% on average, and they reported 29% of their gross personal income was derived from their art sales. Now remember, this is average. For some, it's 100% of their income. Now we'd like to put some faces on these facts. Meet Michael Blessing. He and his wife, Megan, took the MAP workshop in 2009. During that year, the income for their art sales doubled. In 2013, they saw a further increase of 29%. In 2014, their sales increased 43% on top of that, due in large part to Michael being invited to the C.M. Russell Art Auction, which is a really big deal in our state. It's held every March in Great Falls. Now, very exciting, just last Friday night at this latest art auction, Michael had been invited to be one of the quick draw artists who paint over the course of 2 hours while people watch, and then their work is sold. His was the highest selling piece at $75,000. Next, we have a testimonial from an inspired jeweler and leather artist, Olive Parker. She tells us, "I showed for the first time at the highly prestigious Western Design Conference in Jackson." And as a side note, if you've never been, this is a really tony, high-end show. "This was my first public show," she said. "In addition to making a $5,200 sale, I had other sales." Here is some of her incredible leather jewelry. At her very first show, she won a $4,000 award in cash for Best Newcomer's Booth, and she learned how to build this booth and design it from her MAP training. This event opened many more doors for her. Finally, let's visit Richard and Shelley Peters, who exemplify arts-driven economic development the Montana way. They own an alpaca ranch in the beautiful Bitterroot Valley. They raise Surrey alpacas and process and spin their fiber, which we learned is not to be confused with wool or fur. They then send it out to a nearby fiber dyer who uses only natural dyes to create rich and earthy hues. There you can see that beautiful fiber. And finally, they produce fabrics and woven and felted accessories to sell online and in their home-based shop. Shelley and Richard's story is made even more impactful by the number of times they have told us that the MAP program is what kept them on the family ranch. Now that's economic development, big sky country style, where the arts are a viable industry. And when it comes to industry, there is a sign on the side of the school where I went to junior high, it's now an elementary school, in Fort Benton, Montana, in this little town of 1,500 people in Montana, that says it better than I can. Industry is useless without culture. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak before you today. I have provided a packet of information at each of your places for the National Council members that provides some backup to this. And I also want to thank my staff. I have an incredible staff and my board for doing the most excellent work that they always do on behalf of the state and the country. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have. Yes, Maz.
Arlene, thank you for that wonderful presentation. As a fellow Westerner, I really appreciated that. Two quick questions. You said your own Montana Department of Labor did their own study on that. Mm-hmm. Was it because they didn't trust SUNY's numbers, or what were they looking for on that?
No, that's a good question. They took Sunil's numbers, and they actually made sure that they had the same kind of codes. And they wanted to just go over the numbers themselves and put it in their own context. So when we got it from Sunil, it was a lot of data. And what they did was create the stories.
And then that was easier for your state legislators.
Yes, and I don't know about in your state, but in our state, they don't want to believe anything that's from Washington D.C.
So it's not just Sunil.
They think about the NEA, it's more like, is that the NRA? You know what I mean? That's the way it is in Montana.
Those numbers. Other question, you had left Montana?
Yes.
Worked in Texas and New York. What took you back to Montana?
A crop duster.
I think there's more to that story.
So. Well, that's a good way to end.
We may need to include your story in the 50 States, 50 Stories program. Yeah. Thank you, Arni Fishbaugh, so much. Before we continue with our next presenter, I want to temporarily break away to introduce a very special guest. And Congresswoman McCollum, as I'm introducing you, would you be willing to join us at the table here with the council? Congresswoman Betty McCollum from the 4th District of Minnesota. Congresswoman McCollum is an ex officio member of our National Council on the Arts, the ranking member of the Interior Subcommittee, and she has stood for the importance and the value of our arts in our society. Congresswoman McCollum reminds us of the tangible ways that the arts make an impact, including in the economy. And from her position on the House Appropriations Committee, Congresswoman McCollum helped boost the NEA budget to $146 million. And just this week, we saw her at the Americans for the Arts annual congressional breakfast, where she spoke passionately about the arts and advocated for our budget. It is no wonder that 7 years ago, Americans for the Arts, in conjunction with the United States Conference of Mayors, presented the National Award for Congressional Arts Leadership to Congresswoman Betty McCollum. And I had the great pleasure of meeting Congresswoman McCollum. Thank you for letting me join you in your home state back in November. And I'm hoping we'll have the opportunity to meet again when I join in April as well. But I'd like to ask our council members to briefly introduce themselves. So name, where you're from, and your occupation. So Congresswoman McCollum has the opportunity to meet you. Let's start first. Is Dr. Carter still on the phone? Okay, well, let's continue with Ronnie.
I'm Ronnie Ramaswamy from Minneapolis. I'm a choreographer.
I'm Barbara Ernst Prey from Oyster Bay, New York, and I'm a painter.
Maria Jackson from Los Angeles, California. Background's urban planning.
I'm Laura Callanan. I'm the senior deputy chair at the National Endowment for the Arts.
I'm Mas Masumoto from Fresno, California. I'm a writer and organic farmer.
Hi, I'm Deepa Gupta, and I'm a corporate philanthropist for the Boeing Company.
Joan Israelite, an arts consultant from Kansas City.
I'm Paul Hodes, and I'm your former colleague.
Olga Visa, director at the Walker Arts Center in Minneapolis.
My name is Emil Kang. I'm from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and I'm a professor and administrator there.
Thank you so much. And Congresswoman McCollum, invite you to say a few words. We're so glad you're here.
Well, I was in the neighborhood, so I thought I'd stop by. And I'm from the federal government, and I really do want to help you fund the arts. It's a great honor to be one of the appointees by Leader Pelosi and the Speaker of the House to be one of the congressional liaisons. We take the work that we do very seriously, and you're in very capable hands with your chair. Thank you so much for getting out, getting around, and we look forward to hosting you in Minnesota. Promise, well, I won't promise not to have any snow, but we hope it's all gone. The work that you do is incredibly important, and I loved hearing the presenter. Is it Arnie?
Yes.
From, I was trying to read this really quick to catch your first name. My mother is from Montana, and it doesn't surprise me that Big Sky is getting it right for the arts, so congratulations to all of you. So you had a very successful Storm the Hill.
We did.
Lots of activity, lots of excitement on the appropriations. My fellow appropriators in both sides of the aisle, we were talking about what a great job everyone's done. So Keep it up. And my plea always is invite members of Congress out to view the depth and breadth of all that you do in the economy. And as Arnie did, you know, tell the stories because it's economic growth and opportunity. So I just wanted to really thank you for all the work that you do behind the scenes. And, you know, Paul can tell you, we do appreciate it when you invite us out to the offices to see things. So, and in my case,
well, we'd
I'm
like to thank
you.
Thank you so much. Let's go ahead and continue then. Ned Canty.
Thank you, and I'll just introduce Ned. Our next speaker is Ned Canty, the General Director of Opera Memphis. Before joining Opera Memphis in 2011, Ned directed productions of Wolf Trap Opera, Glimmerglass, and the Santa Fe Opera, among others, served as director of the New York Television Festival, and held positions with the Hartford Stage Company and the New York Renaissance Festival. Since assuming leadership in Memphis, the company has emphasized new audience development. In 2012, Ned oversaw the launch of 30 Days of Opera, a month-long series of free public performances. Since its inception, the program has introduced 60,000 people to opera in more than 120 locations across Memphis. Here to tell us more about Opera Memphis's work is, of course, Ned, in audience development, I should say.
Hello, thank you all very much. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to talk to you a little bit about 30 Days of Opera, and thank you to the NEA for your help in starting this program and in continuing it. It really is invaluable. So I'm gonna start with when I first got to Memphis in 2011. If I had asked anybody in Memphis, a board member, a donor, any kind of stakeholder, what does success look like? Because like many opera companies in 2011, we faced some real challenges. They would have told me a balanced budget and sold out shows, both things we were struggling with. Now, obviously a balanced budget, I think probably everybody could agree, that is one of the things we are all looking for. So I wanna talk for a moment about sold out shows. What that would have meant for us in 2011, when we were working at about 55% of capacity on average, put into numbers, that would have meant going from a little over 8,000 people reaching to almost 14,000 people reached in the course of a season. Now, to give you some context about Opera Memphis, much like Arnie did, but my colleagues in New York and on the coast, where I grew up, sometimes forget this, we are the only professional opera company between St. Louis and New Orleans, Little Rock and Nashville. So this is the area of America where we are responsible for opera. And if you took that area and put it on the East Coast, it would go from Boston to North Carolina, and while I'm not a statistician, I believe there's more than one opera company serving that particular area. So that area kind of gives me nightmares. So we tend to focus on our MSA, which is right there at the intersection of Tennessee, Mississippi, and Arkansas with Shelby County in the middle. That's where Memphis is. It's about 1.3 million people, close to 1.4. What that means is that our definition of success in a year was reaching about 1% of the population of our MSA. Again, I'm not a statistician, but that makes absolutely no sense to me. So we needed something new. We all knew we loved opera. We needed something to try to reach that other 99% with something maybe they love. So we spent a lot of time talking about, okay, what does Memphis love? What are the traits? How can we create a program that will meet them there? One of the things Memphis loves is grit and grind. Those are our Memphis Grizzlies, just clinched a playoff spot. Very excited about that. Grit and grind, meaning they work hard. They don't showboat, they don't complain, they don't whine. They show people they mean it by doing rather than saying. That is a sort of core Memphis value. A second thing, Memphis loves the intersection of high and low culture. You see it everywhere in the music, especially in the food. This is my favorite restaurant, Hog and Hominy. You can get a deviled egg with paddlefish caviar on. If you come to Memphis, please reach out to me. I'll tell you where to go. It's a great place. So we decided what we needed to do was turn the opera house inside out and essentially bring La Boheme to Beale Street.
The basic concept of 30 Days of Opera is pretty simple. Every day in the month of September, Opera Memphis will perform somewhere in the city, in the tri-state area. Somewhere we will put on a free performance. Sometimes that performance is for a dozen kids and a couple of librarians at a library in some neighborhood in Memphis. Sometimes it's for thousands of people at the Levitt Shell. Sometimes it's for everybody that we walk by trolley night or at the Cooper Young Festival or some other big outdoor event that we might have. Every performance is different. Every one of them is a different attempt to engage a different part of
as you
the
heard,
city,
the basic format is pretty simple. Every day for 30 days in the month of September, we will do at least one free performance somewhere in Memphis or the Mid-South. Most days it's more than one. Some of them are, we tell people where we're gonna be. Sometimes we just show up somewhere as a surprise. That's what all the empty dates are. Those are days where we didn't want people to know where we're gonna be. A lot of my colleagues say, how did you do this? Especially since we are a very small company. Well, first we hired four fantastic singers who not only were great singers, but were also social media savvy and had no problem going up to someone after a performance and saying, hi, I'm an opera singer. What did you think of that? Do you mind if I interview you? And then we hired a great music director in Ben McKino, who not only could play anything, transpose it on the fly, was willing to carry an electric keyboard on his back while running a 5K, stopping every kilometer to meet a singer and sing for the people running by. We supplemented that with many, many local Memphis artists. Memphis, of course, is full of musicians. So far, over 3 years, we have worked with over 100 other musicians, singers, dancers throughout the city. That's from our Levitt Shell concert, where we had rock trios, a guy playing an anvil, hip-hop dancers, and the fantastic a cappella hip-hop duet Artistic Approach. Once we started planning it, though, in the first year, we made sure we knew who was gonna sing, and then we started calling people, and we said, hi, we're from Opera Memphis. We wanna come and do a free performance at your venue. Yes, free. You don't need to pay anything. No, you don't need to provide any kind of equipment. We will bring everything. Yes, this is not a scam. We're not asking you to send a check so that we could do whatever. Once we started convincing people, we were good to go. Where did we choose? Well, we first looked at places where we knew people would already be gathered, like the Cooper Young Festival that gets tens of thousands of people, the Memphis Downtown Farmers Market, where we perform every year. Then we started reaching out to organizations, some of which we already had a relationship with, some of which we didn't, where we knew they had a venue and they had a list, an email list, a mailing list that might have some overlap with ours, but not a huge amount. And we said to them, we're gonna do this for free. All we're asking is tell all of your folks that it's going on because we don't know how to tell them we're doing this. What did we sing? We started out with the greats. We started out with the things that everybody already knows, they just probably don't know it's opera. So we started out with the Bugs Bunny cartoons, those songs. We started out with the British Airways commercials and the, you know, the Carmen Butter commercials, all of those things. Then we started looking at songs that had a very special Memphis connection. So for instance, O Sole Mio is the same tune as It's Now or Never, sung by Elvis. So we would do a mashup of that to show people some of these connections, to draw a line between Memphis music and opera. We also made sure to have a ton of stuff, both programs and material for kids and families. That was very important to us. That last is a slide from a piece that we wrote especially for 30 Days called The Playground King. It is, as far as I know, still the only opera ever specifically written to be performed in a tree fort. Finally, we tried to make sure that we had some events where the intersection of what we were singing and where we were singing it would get people talking and would create viral spread, not in the sense of viral videos, that time had already long passed by the time we were doing this, but in the sense of viral spread in a heavily networked city like Memphis, where people are constantly seeing each other at church, at the gym, at the market, and love to stay and talk for a minute. So what could we do that would make them talk? Well, for instance, on the very first day of 30 Days of Opera, we went to the biggest dog park in the city, we set up our equipment, we had two singers put on cat ears, and sing the Rossini cat duet, which in case you don't know, it consists entirely of meowing. We then packed up and left and sort of waited to see what would happen. We were trolling Twitter, of course, and we got one of my favorite tweets of all time. Wasn't that hilarious? They sang one song and left, strangest drive-by of all time. More importantly, following that, we got this tweet. Classical music at the dog park, God, how I love Memphis. hashtag I love Memphis. That wasn't the last time we saw that, as well as Choose 901. That's another big pro-Memphis one. Over the course of 3 years, we have hundreds of tweets like this, people talking about what that meant to them and how they felt about their city. We always made sure to have these signs with us with our hashtag so that we could track it, and also so that we could begin a conversation. Because if somebody saw something, we want to tell them where they could see more. Essentially, 30 Days of Opera is a trail of breadcrumbs that we are building that leads to the Opera House. We learned that first from this gentleman, Patrick Woods, who in the very first year drove by us singing on a street corner, got interested, started following us, came to the drop party for a four-song hip-hop EP of La Boheme that we had commissioned, then came to a final concert, then bought a ticket, then became a subscriber, and now, after only 3 years, has gone from absolutely no opera in his life to being a member of the Camarada, our young professionals group, one of the founding members of it, in fact. So that trail of breadcrumbs became more and more important to us, especially because we make sure to go to places not just where we know people need only a nudge to get into opera, but with people, go to places where there are people where we know that this trail might not lead to the Opera House for years or decades. It might not lead to it at our Opera House or even in our city, but somebody needs to put down that first crumb, and we decided that was going to be us. This is a map from the first 2 years. It's actually interactive on our site. If you click on any of those pins, it'll pop up showing where we performed, what we sang, you know, all that sort of stuff. We're hoping to expand that part of it as time goes on. But after the first year, which was a huge amount of fun for everyone, we knew that we needed to start being a little more scientific about things. We needed to start tracking some of this data and really trying to harness this tool that we had. So thanks to a grant from Opera America, through a fund they have that is funded by the Ann and Gordon Getty Foundation, we were able to start administering surveys at all of our events, and surveys with codes and discount codes that allowed us to track what is the impact and what is the spread in ways that were a little more scientific. Through that, we know that over the past 2 years, not including the first year, we've sold 275 tickets that we would not have sold without a 30 days event that was attended by a person. 175 of them were to people who had never been to an opera before. Many of whom now, we aren't gonna finalize data until the end of the year because we still have some kids shows coming up, but already many of those people have come back either as single ticket buyers or as subscribers. We've reached over 60,000 Memphians. That's in addition to our regular season performances. We really don't let the two cross over. These are some of the people we've collaborated with. Sorry that you probably can't read any of those words, but there are words, I promise. It's also allowed us just to hugely expand our collaboration base. You know, people who never knew who we were, we now have longstanding relationships and projects cooking for them. With those surveys, and this is the stat that I find most important and most exciting, more than 90% of people strongly agreed that the performance they attended made them feel better about their community, made them feel better about their city. And with a city like Memphis that is similar to many cities across the country that is experiencing the first stages of a renaissance, but is trying to make sure that A, they bring in creative capital, they bring in young professionals, they retain them, and they overwhelm the sort of lingering negative attitudes that many people who've lived there for a long time have. That kind of data is hugely important, not only to show people, but to have. I am, however, more of a storyteller than a data guy, so last little bits of data, you know, we got 13,800 was our goal. We're up to 60 with 30 days, which of course, the way I look at it, means that we are just getting started. We have just begun doing this. You know, getting anybody to come to anything is a house-to-house battle. There is nothing easier than not going to the opera. I'm guessing most of you are going to do that today. Most people do. But because I'm not a data guy, I do tend to look at certain stories, because when you're asking your staff to go 30 days without a day off, you need stories to inspire them. Like this young woman who saw her first opera and went home and spent the next 5 days writing and performing her own operas with her friends. This young woman from the Stax Music Academy who heard live opera for the first time and gave us a review of two smiley face heart-eyed emoticons, which is the equivalent of a rave from Anne Majette, I'm pretty sure. This gentleman here grew up in one of the poorest neighborhoods in Memphis. He is a security guard at the Levitt Shell, where we do an annual concert. he spent the week before our first concert there teasing the executive director that it was going to be boring. It was going to be long. Nobody was going to come. And the executive director found him backstage halfway through with tears in his eyes. He said he never knew how beautiful the music was. He always thought that opera was for rich white people and not for people like him. And now, not only is he a member of the Opera Memphis family, the experience inspired him to go and pursue a dream that he had given up decades ago of learning how to play the piano. So we talked a lot about the definition of success here. For me, the definition of success is, a lot of people will say, when I get interviewed about the program, people will say, so you're bringing opera to the people. Success for me is when they stop saying that. Because the truth of the matter is that that's not what this program is about. Opera already belongs to the people. What we are doing is going out there because for some reason they've either forgotten it or they've been told that it isn't true. All we are doing is going out and reminding everyone that opera has been theirs from the beginning. So thank you all very much for listening. Oh, do I answer? Stay here for questions? Go back for questions?
Any questions from the council?
Yes, I'd like to get down on the weeds a little bit, just to, you know, how you actually ran this program. So you like, who on the staff coordinated all this for you? How did you fund it? Approximately what is the cost of all this? And are other opera companies around the country looking at this and trying to replicate it?
Sure. In order of asking, in the first year, we had someone who was an incoming artist director candidate in our artist diploma candidate in directing. We paid him to be the sort of road manager. But in terms of staff, when I first told the staff about this, that had already been overworked and demoralized, I made an unfortunate promise that nobody would have to work anymore to make the program happen. So in the first year, it was me, which was actually a lot of fun, and it really allowed me to have firsthand the kinds of insights into what was working and what wasn't. As we've gone on, the responsibilities, as we've sort of figured out how to make it work, the responsibilities are split between our director of operations and our director of education. I still sort of oversee things and handle most of the higher level programming and interactions. You know, one of the most important things about this is that we not treat it as a sideline or a secondary thing, that this is as important to our company as any main stage production. This, we pay the singers the same as we would pay them to sing in Tosca. So it's not an afterthought. It's, if anything, it's the core of what we're doing. And you had some others. Oh, yes. So I've spoken with several. I know that at least a couple have applied for grants using the materials. You know, we would welcome anybody who wants to do this. And I know, you know, Opera America, this is their number one priority. They've been helping us work on the program. You know, anyone out there who wants advice or feedback on how to do it or wants to use our Opera Giant, you know, IP or whatever, we're happy to talk to them because it's been a game changer for us in Memphis. It has really turned almost everything around. In terms of how it's paid for, it is a combination of foundation support and corporate sponsorship. It actually is a program that lends itself to sponsorship far better than a lot of the things we do, and anybody who's interested in that, I could talk more. I could have done a presentation just on that portion of it, about the sponsorship portion. So it's presented by Evolve Bank and Trust. AutoZone helps out every year as well. But we also built it to be scalable. You know, if when people ask me how much the program costs, it's very hard for me to not say how much you got, because we could do it. We have enough people who love opera in Memphis. We could do it for very little money. But the more money we have, the more reach we have, the more people we can hire, the more we can make sure that people know where it's going on. So, you know, give me $1 million and I'll show you an incredible month of opera. Right now, it averages around $50,000 to $75,000. Last year, higher because we bought a van through a grant.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
How do the artists feel about the performances as it's grown in, mm-hmm. As part of their work scope, but also as part of their artistry? It sounds like you're doing a lot of special commissions, or at least getting new arrangements and compositions mm-hmm. done as you try to make each piece relevant. Could you talk a little bit about that body of work?
Sure. You know, I think the Playground King, this piece, this kids piece that we commissioned for the 30 days, that actually is being done next year by another company that is also looking at 30 days, but they're starting with Playground King because it functions as an introduction to opera, but it also has, it works well as a school tour show. The artists themselves, well, I know that the couple of them that we didn't hire back were very sad and angry with me, so I guess they liked it. They have followed along. They've in many cases, because we are getting people who are in the earlier stages of their careers, as they get more work, it gets harder to get 5 months from them. And you know, we have hired many of them now to come and be in main stage shows as well. I think that the other collaborators, that's been one of the most exciting things. You know, we had Artistic Approach, this a cappella hip hop duet, perform their version of Summertime, which is technically opera, but it's amazing. You can download it, it's fantastic. And they did that at this Levachelle concert, and it was opera like no one had ever heard it, but it was opera, and it was great. And so drawing those lines between types of music in a city like Memphis, where everybody thinks, here's all of Memphis music and opera's way over there somewhere. I mean, that's vital. And I think the fact that we have not even said to people, meet us halfway. We've said, we're gonna meet you 99.9% of the way with what you're doing, and then let us draw the lines back. I think people have taken to that very well.
Anyone else? Thank you so much, Ned.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Finally, we'll hear from Ellin O'Leary from Youth Radio. Ellin worked as a reporter, news director, and producer in television and radio before she founded Youth Radio in 1992. Based in Oakland, California, the organization brings the youth perspective to mass audiences while training young people to master digital media and technology. The organization's reach is broad, and emphasis is placed on teaching diverse, low-income youth the skills needed to succeed in the creative industries of tomorrow. Joining Ellin today is Storm White, a fellow at Youth Radio Interactive and a current student at Berkeley City College. Accomplished in graphic design, data visualization, and app development, Storm recently won Oakland's My Brother's Keeper hackathon for her idea for My Study Buddy, which would allow local community college students to form social and study networks based on their classes and majors. Ellin and Storm will talk about the Remix Your Life project and the Arts Pathways Initiative. Ellin and Storm?
Thank you so much. It's such an honor to be here, and after our colleagues, it's inspiring to be in this room. Youth Radio combines storytelling with art and technology, and in the process, there's transformation in both the individual student level and for our community. This morning, we'll take you inside so you can see what it looks like at Youth Radio, and we'll share some of the outcomes and takeaways for building this kind of work. We want to thank the NEA for making all of this possible, and I mean all of it, as early supporters. In 2007, Youth Radio moved from a storefront in Berkeley to this 20,000 square foot former bank in Oakland. We purchased the bank and then developed and built it out as a media and technology arts center. Our board, staff, and students had posed the question, can a youth-driven youth media and arts organization be a force in economic revitalization of downtown Oakland? 8 years later, the answer that we've come to is yes. 300 students a year, ages 14 to 24, have jobs at Youth Radio, and they've definitely transformed their own trajectories, their families, and the community.
Welcome to Youth Radio in downtown Oakland. Come on in. Youth Radio is an award-winning organization. Youth Radio is many things. It's a media production company, a youth training facility, and a workforce development center. We started off with a two-minute commentary on local broadcasts about 20 years ago, and now we're a national model for workforce development and journalism training. This is our first floor training area. Here we do everything from blogging, graphic design, video production and editing, show production with hosting and scripting, media literacy work, and music production. The way our classes are taught are with a cascading mentorship model, which means that students from past classes come back to teach the next generation of leaders and learners.
Radio started out as a radio journalism training program, but now we're working in all formats in photography, graphics, video, print, and online. We distribute content online through the Huffington Post, National Geographic, and a wide array of major outlets, both local and national. Youth Radio is NPR's official youth desk, covering everything from elections, the latest technology, racial profiling, and the malls.
This morning we visit Stockton, a heart
town in Northern California. After the recession, it became one of the largest American cities to file for bankruptcy. Crime went up, businesses closed, and Forbes magazine declared it one of the worst places to live in the country. But things are starting to turn around in Stockton. A new music scene is emerging from an unlikely place. Youth Radio's Raphael Johns has more.
I'm outside a strip mall in Stockton, California. It's got a big Asian grocery store, a pet shop, and a secondhand store called D-Thrift. There's about 50 kids my age, all in their late teens and early 20s, talking and smoking in front of an empty storefront. It used to be a cell phone shop, and before that, a place that sold diet pills. Tonight, it's the D-Thrift concert venue, with headliners, Stockton's own Satan Riders.
Of course, young people also tell their stories by composing music, writing poetry, and singing. Remix Your Life is Youth Radio's artistic development program, started by young staff and students. We've developed a live performance space next door at 1719 Broadway for their performances. The venue is a destination now on Oakland's Art Walk, the Lit Walks, and much more.
Technology is another major thread linking all of our work at Youth Radio. In the past few years, Youth Radio has moved its focus from just broadcast and journalism to web development and design. Traditionally, technology is seen as science or STEM, but we now recognize it as an art. At Youth Radio Interactive, we incorporate coding and design into our journalism to create websites and apps that address issues facing our community. These projects invite our audiences to not only listen to our stories, but engage with them. For example, YRI created a Youth Radio app that not only features our award-winning stories, it also adds a prompt so that the listener can add to the story. With support from partners such as the National Science Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation, and MIT's App Inventor Project, Youth Radio has created a department that teaches students the larger experience of working in the tech industry. The curriculum is not just about coding, it's about creating an app from start to finish. This includes everything from the ideation process to the publishing an app on Youth Radio websites or the Google Play Store. At Youth Radio Interactive, we are learning by doing and creating products that add to national conversations around pressing issues that reach real audiences. And now, here's a video of my colleagues and I showing you a glimpse of the work that we do.
This is the design for the Youth Radio app, which has gone through a whole bunch of editing. How we had it before is that there were two images, one for feature stories and one for the audio stories, and we had this whole bar, navigation bar going on at the bottom. But the design was not as user-friendly and is not as simple as we needed it to be. We got rid of the navigation bar, we just threw it away. Instead, we ended up with a lot more space, which meant that we can fit more content on the screen, our images can be a little bit bigger, and then the user feels a lot less cramped.
Another way Youth Radio engages in digital arts and storytelling is through its digital communication workforce. This is a six-month workforce program for students ages 18 to 24 that provides training in basic design and professional development skills. It's paid, and it comes with college credit. I was a student in the workforce program and learned design using Photoshop and additional skills such as mastering Microsoft Office and using design to create and enhance small business proposals.
The workforce program also provides a variety of internship placement opportunities in Oakland. For example, I interned as a creative at Carol H. Williams Advertisement, where I worked with a team who contributed to product development and advertising materials. We worked for clients like the YMCA, the Oakland Airport, and Google. Through this youth radio program, I've learned not just the technical skills I needed, but also how to use these skills to make art and tell stories through design and technology.
And at Youth Radio, we emphasize diversity, economic and cultural diversity. We engage about 3,000 students a year, 80% being low income and coming from low performing schools. We have about 300 jobs a year, and of course reach millions of people through the variety of audiences. 98% of our students are graduating from high school, which is probably double the rate in Oakland, and 88% are going to some kind of post-secondary opportunity. So as we're all thinking about impact and scale, another way we're thinking about it is in terms of on the media side, by developing a national news network. And through our teaching side, we're growing it in distribution through this online portal, Teach Youth Radio. And we've also launching a series of boot camps around the country right now in a partnership with Best Buy. When looking at the takeaways from youth radio and other people looking to developing programs, similar programs around the country, we looked at three main takeaways. Top quality everything in terms of staff and equipment in particular, artistic freedom, and large audiences. And finally, of course, support from the National Endowment for the Arts, which has made, again, all of this possible. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ellen and Storm. Any questions from the council?
Yes, this is a marvelous program, and I'm interested in the early days. I mean, how did this all begin? And, you know, the name Youth Radio, I mean, obviously you're doing much, much more than, you know, what the name seems to indicate, but I'd be interested in the genesis.
I think the genesis was actually in the 90s, in a time not dissimilar to now, when there was a lot of violence in urban communities, and I was out there as a reporter, and seeing all these stories in the news about gangs and you know, the kind of horror stories that are the main fare of covering teens. But when I went out to cover them and went to these schools, I was just finding these really intelligent young people with so many talents, and you know, it was more the communities and the adults running through the campuses that were the problem rather than the students. And then so with a group of students, we just decided to do a summer program together. After the money ran out, they didn't want to go. So it just started. So that's where the peer teaching model started. Originally, mm-hmm. It was because there was no money. And they said, it's okay, we'll teach the next kids. And it's been passed on since then. Yeah. And we're able to attract a lot of creative staff because people, we have a, you know, different professions together. So we have, you know, youth development type people, we have technology reporters, artists, so all in the same space with young people. So we're able to attract top talent if people, because of the creative freedom and the kind of energy that comes out of working in a partnership with young people.
A quick question. I heard your programs on NPR. Sometimes I think California Report picks them up too. Where, as you scaled up, what was the turning point? Was it leadership? Was it more resources? Was it inspiration from the youth?
You mean scaled up locally or nationally?
There had to be a turning point when you...
Mm-hmm. Again, it was really the young people who would keep it going. And we would end up pretty much following their lead. And that's how we've gone from being... Because we also started to be in the midst of an incredible dynamic change in terms of technology and the entire industry of media changing. And they're the early adopters, and low-income urban kids are the earliest adopters. So they were of new technology and culture trends. So we would be, essentially the adults would be following them. So that would keep it going. I think, all the professionals who've come, including my colleague who's here, Rebecca Martin, who's a managing editor, have brought their own networks. So we all had networks at NPR and other places. And so as we brought those networks in, which continues to this day with the partnership with MIT and everything else, other people would want to be involved in it on their end.
Mrs. Storm, did you realize you were leading this?
No, not at all. I started off going because I didn't know. I was in high school when I started going. I was my senior year, and I didn't know really what I wanted to do when I went to college. And so I said to myself, why not? Youth Radio has so many things I could do. And I didn't think I'd end up in graphic design because I was a theater focus. So being at this point is a complete 180 from where I was.
Well, congratulations. Wonderful work.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the presentation. It's really inspiring. All of them today have been very inspiring. I'm wondering, what do you see? You've seen so much change in technology, in the ways in which kids can learn by doing, and adults too, frankly, in sort of reverse mentoring ways. I'm wondering what you both see as kind of the next frontier with the new changes that are coming in. So you've gone from radio to visual arts and to graphic arts and design and online things, but there must be a direction that maybe the kids are taking you, or that maybe the times are taking you, and I'm wondering what that looks like.
I think the way information is being delivered is, it's just completely different depending on age and group. Not that older people don't cross over. We just spent a couple days at NPR, looking at their analytics, let's say. 50% of their audience online is coming from Facebook. It's like 3% go directly to their website. So in terms of, and websites kind of going away. So and that's why I think the work that everyone here is doing, and I know when Jane came to visit, which students were saying, oh, you're going to see Jane. she was a hit. we're talking about this idea of, that this generation, which I think Storm could talk to, and I think you both, your projects showed it too, that the creative process is no longer that solitary process. And we're even talking about voting will be people sitting together in a cafe on their laptops. Civic engagement too, and going, what do you think of this person? What do you think of this person? That I think that these generations, they're breaking down all these walls, right? We see all the walls are breaking down in terms of, gender, ethnicity, all those things. And I think their motif is just, right? What would you say about how you work together?
I think that using social media and using technology is so much a daily part of our lives that it does break down those borders of, I don't have to just sit and talk to you in a classroom. I can I'm always inspired to talk about things that are important and relevant to people who are either in my classroom or like miles and miles away. So it makes discussing and sharing and collaborating that much easier. And I think that over time, that'll be like the most basic part of how we communicate and how we share and how we develop ideas.
I think we have a colleague who's really focusing on how digital media, digital learning, that I'm hoping to connect to the work here too, because I think the technology piece isn't separate. Like for you, Storm, wasn't it, you came in as a graphic designer, but then they were saying to her, well, why don't you code it?
Yeah.
Wasn't, and you know, to me that would be like,
It was. But I had no idea how to code, but I mean, it made sense turning a design or a piece of artwork into letters and numbers on a computer. Like I had never even thought of that before, but it's not that much different. When you learn it and when you think about it, it's all the same.
Storm, Ellen, Ned, Arni, let's thank all our presenters. And thank you too, Sunil. Now for our final piece of business, we have one more, and I'm pleased to announce that the National Council on the Arts has reviewed the applications and guidelines presented to them, and a tally of the council members' ballots reveals that all recommendations for funding and rejection have passed. Any other comments, questions, discussion from the council members? It is, I want to thank the entire NEA staff. It's such an honor for me to be able to work with you. Thank you for all your work. I'm just pumped to be able to work with this council. You're awesome. Thank you for your insights, and thank you for helping us learn from you as well. I'm looking forward to seeing you at the next council meeting next June, or this coming June. And so now the 184th meeting of the National Council on the Arts is adjourned.